Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Aren't you glad your hope is in Him? Praise God. I used to put my hope in a lot of other things in this world, but they just didn't pan out. Amen? But I tell you what, the Lord Jesus Christ has never failed me. Never failed me, not one time. Amen. If there's any failings, if there's any shortcomings, if there's any fly in the ointment, it's this old guy right here. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
I will wait on you.
Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Did you see the leaves today? I mean, nobody can do that. Could paint a picture like the Lord. Amen. Woo! It was pretty.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
That heaven can heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal. So lay down your burden, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your hopeless and all those who strayed. Come sit at the table, come taste of his grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can cure. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can cure.
Amen. Hallelujah. Who believes that?
So lay down your burden. That heaven can heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal. So lay down your burden, lay down your shame.
Yeah. Jesus, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. You know, as we was doing that song, I was thinking about whenever I was in the Boy Scouts, whenever I was a pup, and we go out on these hikes and stuff, and we would mark trees and mark this and mark that, or lay some stones or do different things. The farther that we got, we kept going, we kept marking our spot and everything, so we could find the trail back. And it was just part of scouting. But I was thinking about before Christ came into my life. And all of us, we got a long way out there. We got a long way out there. And we didn't mark no trail because we didn't think there was any way back. You know, we've often said, if I'd have known I was going to live this long, I'd have took better care of myself. So we really wasn't looking to find that way back. But you know, God is so good. You know, and I think about that star that shines so brightly for the wise men to find that little bitty baby in the manger, and they traveled so far following that star. You know what? I don't know. Somewhere in the darkness, somewhere in the blackness, we saw a star, didn't we?
Yes.
His name's Jesus.
Light.
And he showed us the way home. You know, he just kept saying, turn around and I'll show you the way back. And he showed us the way back. Praise God. That was a miracle. That was a miracle. Amen. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're a miracle. A miracle. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Miracles. Amen. You may be seated tonight if you can. Lord, thank you, Lord. Amen. God in all of his mercy. Amen. He had a plan. He knew from the very start that we were going to be here October the 25th, 2017. He already knew. He already knew. He had a plan. He knew one day we were going to give up. We were going to say, I'm lost. I can't find my way home. I don't know where to go from here. I don't know what step to take. I don't know how to do this. But aren't you glad that God had a plan and he knew that? He knew that. And he had to make it real simple for us. Too simple. It's so simple that it's almost hard to believe, isn't it? Because usually we say if it sounds too much like a good deal, then it probably is. Not this time. I would venture to say, well, I know, because if it wasn't real, I wouldn't be here and you wouldn't be here. Right? Amen. God is real. He's not a myth. He's not the tooth fairy. He's not the Easter bunny. You know, all those myths that we grew up with. He is real. He's real tonight. I feel his presence here. I just want to say, if you don't know him, if you haven't turned around, I just challenge you to turn around, yes. Take a chance, follow the star. Let him lead you home. Doesn't matter where you've been, doesn't matter what you've done.
Man.
You just turn around. Same road that got you lost will bring you home. Just turn around. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. It's good to see everyone here tonight. Amen. I want to welcome everyone. Welcome our guests, our visitors. And if you don't have a church home, we just invite you to hang around with us. Come and go on the journey with us. We're having the time of our life. And we just invite you to be a part of that. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Got a few announcements that I want to make real quick. The Trinity Lutheran Church over here in Ellisville has had a food pantry going now for quite some time. And they are offering Thanksgiving food baskets this year, a complete meal in a box. If you have more questions about that, you can pantry279.org. And they also need volunteers. Donations are accepted. If you have any questions immediately, you can ask Brother Barney back there. He's been helping them out. And is there any more to go with that? It's almost all of Ellisville.
Amen.
Amen. All right.
Praise God.
Awesome. Unchained members, please note that the Putnamville Prison Revival is coming up on Friday, November the 17th, and also on Saturday the 18th, so the sign-up sheet has been posted. Once again, no nicknames. Sign your name as it appears on your ID. And Sunday will be the last day to sign up. So get her done. There is also morning prayer. I want to remind everyone from Monday through Friday right here at the House of Prayer from 6 a.m. to 8 a.m. You can stop by, stay for a few minutes or the entire time, whatever you like, whatever's convenient. For more information, you can contact Teresa Brandenburg. She's moving backwards.
Uh-oh.
What's going on? Oh. God's Armor Bearer Class 1 will start on Tuesday, November the 7th at 7 p.m. This class is to give an understanding of the role of the armor bearer to his leader, to get an understanding that the armor bearer is not an office, but it's an attitude. It's to learn that everyone in the local church should carry the spirit of an armor bearer, and it is the heart of a servant to be the greatest in the kingdom of God, is to be a servant of all. So if you have any questions, you can see Mr. Tim Jeffers right there. It's a great class. How many's taken the armor bearer class? Yeah. Hey, there's a lot of clientele out there. You need to sign up. Okay. All right. Now, my wonderful ladies of our cleaning ministry have been finding
money
pop containers, food wrappers. Don't let them catch you. It will not be good. You have been warned. See, I'm pleading here. I'm trying to save lives.
Yeah. We're not supposed to.
So please.
Uh-oh.
Finish your food in the car.
Yes.
Don't be trashing out the sanctuary. We just paid, what did we pay? My goodness, nearly $1,500 just to have the carpet clean. We're trying to sneak out a few more months out of it. It needs to be replaced, I know, but it still looks nice. If we can keep, you can have water. What's the matter with water? I don't see nowhere in the Bible where it says God made pop. Nowhere. It's not in there. You'll not find it. Not there, is it, Mike? So please. I know I'm preaching to the choir here tonight. Nobody in here on Wednesday nights would do such
none
a thing.
No.
So if you see anybody come in on Sunday, turn them in.
No, turn them in. Right, I don't know.
All right. Let's all stand together. We'll ask our ushers to come as we continue our worship with our giving tonight. Thank you, Lord. Hey, I grew up in a household. My mother had a broom parked outside every door that went into the house. And if you couldn't brush it off your shoes, you took your shoes off. Well, you know, would you just, you know, and I had a former pastor that said, boy, if some of you people treated your home like you do the house of God, I'd hate to stop by and see you. And I bet if you stopped by and help with the cleaning ministry, I bet you'd think about it, right? It's not too much to ask, is it? All right. Smile, I love you. All right. All right. If you have your tithe, your offering in your hand, let's lift it up to the Lord. We stand on the word of God. Luke 6:38 tells us to give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that you give, it shall be given unto you again. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, thank you, Jesus.
Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess, Christ is Lord forever. Well, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Well, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. His name, oh, I just can't stop praising His name, oh, I just can't stop praising the name of Jesus. No, I just can't stop praising His name, oh, I just can't stop praising His name, oh, I just can't stop praising the name of Jesus. Every knee shall bow, every tongue Christ is Lord forever. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Brother Doug, Paul, would you lift up your voice, brother, and bless these tithing offerings. Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. 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 Are you hungry for some word tonight? The bread of life. Amen. Pastor Mike Kelly. Come on up, brother.
Well, praise the Lord, everyone. God is good. Amen. Yep, all the time. God is good. Anybody ever go through any troubles or problems or trials or anything like that? No? How many know 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13 says, "There hath no temptation taking you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful." Amen. "Who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it." Amen. Oh, thank you. I think of that way of escape as the big red panic button, right? When it gets to be too big or too overwhelming, you hit the panic button. Right, and a chute opens up, and you go sliding out, and you end up on a Caribbean beach somewhere. And and then I wake up. Yeah. No, I don't want to hit the button, though, because I don't want to have to start over and do it all over again and get back to that place, right? I mean, no, God grows us up, and God knows what it takes. Amen. How many know our God is a good God, and He is a good Father, and He knows how to accomplish the work that He has started in you? Amen. And He does give us that option to hit the panic button, but we don't want to do it. And I just want to encourage somebody here this evening that if you're really going through something right now, and it just seems like everything is in play, everything is up in the air, everything is falling apart. How many know that's a setup, right? That's a setup. I've been there before. You've probably been there before. How many know there is a solution to the circumstance or the situation that you're in? Hang in there. Don't give up. Don't quit. Don't panic. It always gets darkest right before the dawn, right? So I just want to encourage you to hang in there. The last time I spoke to you, and talked to you about vessels. And when I started off, I said, "Is it okay for a fat man to talk to you about a diet?" Right? Because in a lot of these things, that's what I feel like. Right? I don't say that I have mastered all of these things. The Word of God is true whether I live it or not. Right? It's true. And a lot of times people have a problem with that. They only say or only talk about the things that they have mastered and stuff. But how many know the Word of God goes far beyond our experience and what we know? And it's there to challenge us and to encourage us. And so again, this evening, I kind of want to head off into that territory again, into some areas that, like Paul would say, you know, he said that... he's not saying that he's already attained these things, but this one thing he said he did, he kept pressing, right? He kept pressing towards the mark of the high calling of Christ Jesus, right? Ephesians chapter 4 talks about that. I'm just going to throw down some talking points here to get us going. But Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, the Bible tells us that he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Verse 12 tells us, "For the perfecting of the saints." How many know that's you? Whether you feel like one or not, if you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you're a saint. Amen. And for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all, look at your neighbor and tell them we're talking about you, right? Till we all come into the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, right? How many know that's not when all the Baptists look at it like the Methodists or vice versa? Right? I don't think that kind of unity is ever going to get there, right? We're talking locally right here amongst ourselves. We're pressing towards a mark, amen? In this body of believers, we want to be the best that we can possibly be. We want to hit the goal, and it's going to talk to us about what the goal is, right? It says, till we all come into the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God. How many know there's things that we need to know? Unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. How many know He is our goal, right? If you go and work out in the gym, you might have a picture of Arnold Schwarzenegger, right, on the wall, and you have a mirror beside that, and you do one of those. I'm not going to do that again. That was your one chance. But you look in the mirror, you look at Arnold, got a ways to go, right? Got a ways to go. Amen. That's right. And, well, we should, in our prayer closet, right, we should have on the wall a picture of Jesus and a mirror, right? And we look into the mirror, and then we look over at Jesus, and we can see, like Paul, we have not already attained, but this one thing I do, right? I keep pressing, right? I keep pressing, going to the goal until I look like Jesus, right? I mean, you know, it's attainable. The Bible wouldn't tell us to shoot for it if it wasn't attainable. Right? That's not like something that we have to be embarrassed about. A lot of times people have a problem with the word perfect. You know, well, I'm not perfect. I'm, you know, blah, blah. Well, God's called us to be like Jesus. He was perfect. Right? So I think it goes hand in hand. We don't need to get all tripped up about it, but we need to know what the goal is. We need to continue to press in that direction. One reason why people have troubles with that is they don't really understand what Jesus was all about, right? They understand that Jesus was God, but they don't understand the part about Him being man. They don't understand that when He came to this earth, He divested Himself of His godliness. They call it the kenosis of Christ. He laid aside His godliness, and He walked this earth as a man filled with the Holy Spirit. And He did it to demonstrate what Adam was all about, right? Adam was the first Son of God, right, that God created. Jesus came back to show us, to give us an example of what a Holy Spirit man looked like, right? When Jesus went around laying hands on the sick and they recovered, they didn't recover because He was God. They recovered because He was a man filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. And so the idea of attaining the stature or the fullness of Christ is real. It's what God wants us to do. Jesus said in John 21, He said, because I go to the Father, you're going to do greater things than I did. Not necessarily greater in magnitude, right? Like he opened blinded eyes, we're going to do something bigger and better than that. It's the fact that God knew to reach this world, just one man, one Holy Spirit man, wasn't going to get it done, right? Jesus said, I have to go back, right? I have to go back so that I can send back to you the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, and He is going to come on in the inside of you. He's going to dwell on the inside of you, and we're going to have sons of God running all over the earth, and they're going to be laying hands on the sick. They're going to be speaking to hurricanes and tornadoes and all of these different things. They're going to be declaring the goodness of God and the way of salvation and all these things, because Jesus was just one man in one place, right? That is the goal for each and every one of us, is that we would grow up into being just like Jesus. Amen? All right, so it says in verse 14 there of Ephesians chapter 4, it says that we henceforth be no more children. How many know there is a progression, right? Sanctification is where the Holy Spirit turns you into looking more and more and more like Jesus. We believe in progressive sanctification. It's a process, right? And so we could say on one end, you're an infant, you're a child, you're a teenager, you're a young adult, you're middle age, right? There's a progression. And we want to progress. I mean, it's important to be progressing, right? It's not okay to remain a child. Paul upbraided the Corinthians when he saw them. He said, you know, there's a lot that I would like to talk to you about, right? There is so much more to what this being a Christian is all about than just getting some fire insurance and making it to heaven. Amen. I mean, there's far more. Most everything that your Bible, my Bible, talks about has to do with the here and now, not the someday in the by and by, right? How many know heaven's going to take care of itself? God's wanting you to know how to operate and how to function in this earth. Amen. How many know God loves people, and God is in the process of saving the world, right? If you want to be walking hand in hand and step footstep and footstep with the Lord, salvation, getting out there, getting the message to lost people, that's where God is, right? And there is a timetable, and it's clicking by, and it's, you know, every time the sun goes around, or we go around the sun, and all of these different things, time is passing by, and God is in a hurry, right? He's trying to get the message out. He is looking for people to do the work. He wants you. He wants me to grow up. Right? He wants us to grow up. So he says, so verse again, verse 14, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. But speaking the truth in love, we may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. Right? And so we want to grow up. I want to grow up. And when we're in the middle of these battles, how many know God is putting the pressure on, right, to get us to move? Right? Been learning a thing or two about horses here recently, and how many horses don't like pressure, right? They're like people. They don't like pressure. You put pressure on them, it causes them to move. When you remove the pressure, that lets them know that they're doing the right thing, right? And sometimes we're that way. God wants to speak to us face to face. That's how God wants to talk. He wants to talk to you just like you would talk to your best friend. But sometimes we don't give God the opportunity to be able to speak to us that way. So he has to just kind of bop us on the head. You know, go this way, go that way, go this way, go that way. But he wants the relationship to be much more than that. And so to kind of talk about that, I'm talking about this evening, talking about being led by God's Holy Spirit. 1 Thessalonians 5:23, again, just to continue to kind of lay down some groundwork, some comp, so we're all on the same page. The Bible says, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, or wholly, the King James would say, wholey, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the Monday night Bible study, I talked about the fact that we are tripartite beings. You are a spirit that possesses a soul and lives inside of a body, right? This isn't just extracurricular kind of stuff. This is something that you must understand if you're going to understand Scripture and understand what God's plan is for your maturity, your growing up. You have to understand who you are, what your makeup is, so that you can understand the different parts and how they work within the framework that God has created. And in the Monday night Bible study, I used three cups to demonstrate spirit, soul, and body. I've used circles on a whiteboard. But how many know God gave us a an image. He gave us something to consider, to understand how he created us, and that is the tabernacle or the temple of God, right? The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 19, Paul the Apostle speaking says, "Or do you not know?" How many know when Paul is trying to get something across that people should know, but he knows they don't know, he's usually saying things like, "Do you not know?" Right? "Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own." Right? How many know when God gave Moses the pattern in the wilderness of the tabernacle, how many know he was giving them a, what's the word? I'm trying to, an illustration, a blueprint, a picture, a template, yes, sir. Something that we can understand. God knows that sometimes we have a hard time. Jesus spoke in parables, right? Parables are earthly stories that have spiritual meaning so that we can understand spiritual things. And God, throughout the entire Old Testament, everything that God did with the children of Israel is there as an example so that we can understand spiritually what God is doing in our lives, right? We were in the land of bondage, were we not? We were in the land of Egypt, but our Moses came, or our Joseph came, right? Jesus came. He came and he led us out of the land of bondage. He took us through the waters of baptism, like the Red Sea. And after we came out of the Red Sea, we came to the mount, right? And the Holy Spirit came down on the mountain in fire, and they were given the Ten Commandments. God came down on the day of Pentecost, right? And in your Pentecost, and he came down, and he had put his Ten Commandments inside of your heart. And then he led you out into the wilderness of sin, where you and I are supposed to follow the cloud by day and the fire by night, right? God has put all of these things there as examples so that we can understand what he's trying to do with you and I. And the temple or the tabernacle is no different, right? There is an outer court. There is a holy of holies. And then there is the most holy place, right? The outer court is your body. The holy place is your soul, your mind, your will, and your emotions. The holy of holy, or the most holy place, that is the spirit of man. And that is where God's spirit dwells on the inside of a believer, right? And everything is supposed to emanate out of your spirit. But how many know for years and years and millennia, we as people, we have been controlled by our soul, all right, our mind, our will, and our emotions. And the Bible, we'll read here in just a little bit, tells us if that's the way you live, it's death, right? To be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. But so God's Spirit, right, he comes and he dwells. He comes down upon the ark, right? It's right down here in your belly. It all has a place, right? The soul of man dwells up here in your mind, your body. That's pretty obvious. But the spirit of man is in the belly, right? In the belly. Out of the belly shall flow rivers of living, life-giving water, right? Out of your belly. When you're in a church service or you're in a spiritual environment, it's your belly that gets to jumping, right? It's your belly that gets the tingles and all that stuff, right? When you feel like you need to come down and, you know, respond to whatever call was given or whatever the message was, right? It's your belly that gets to moving. And if you start operating in the gifts of the Holy Spirit and stuff, you'll find that you look down. You look down into your belly. That's where the messages come. Now, some people might do a message out of their head. It's all on paper. It's all this, that, and everything. But how many know the spirit of man wants to do things? And it's down. The first time I had kind of recognition of this, I remember I was getting up to actually come here to preach, and I couldn't get it on paper for anything and everything. I just could not seem to get it ordered out and get it on paper. And I'd been up a lot, and I was in the shower, and it was just like the words and the phrases were just like zinging by. And when I looked at them, it was like I was looking down, and I was looking down into a black whatever container. You know, it was didn't have light, but a phrase that I was like, oh, I need to grab that. I want to say that. Or, ooh, that's a good idea. It was just like zinging around, right? Why? Because that was all in my spirit. It wasn't in my mind. And if you've ever spoken or preached or anything, you know there's that struggle between your mind and your spirit, right? Your mind is like trying to organize it and grab on, but there comes a moment that you just got to step out in faith, right? You just got to stand up. And I want to encourage some of you, if you're out in the jails or the prison and you're like, oh no, I could never do that. I could never. It's not about you anyway, right? Because once you stand up and you open your mouth, it's going to be over in just a little bit, and you're going to be like, oh my gosh, how in the world did I do that? Why? Because it was down here in your spirit, and all we had to do was get past your mind and uncork your spirit, and out it came, right? But we as Christians, we live locked down in our mind. We want everything lined out. We want God to give us, you know, 3 days in advance, give us the outline for the day, and you have it all. That's your mind, logic and reason and all of those kind of things. And it's not that those things are totally bad, but your spirit is not logic and reason, right? Your mind is logic and reason. So your body, and I don't want to go into too much detail on all this, but your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, the whole you. Is the temple of the Holy Spirit. The outer court, the inner court, or the holy place, and the most holy place, right? God was giving us an illustration to show us these three parts. And it's out of that third part, or the first part, however you want to look at it. I like to look at it the first part, because that's the way we should look at it. And the way we should say it is that we are a spirit that possesses a soul and lives in a body. Right? That's how we should look at it. But your spirit man is what it's all about. Right? And depending on how strong your spirit man is will determine how victorious you are as a Christian. Right? If your soul, your mind, your will, your emotions, and your body, those two together is what the Bible calls the flesh. Right? The two of them together. If they're strong, you're going to have all kinds of trouble. Because how many of the Bible says that the flesh or the soul of a man is at enmity with God? It doesn't want to listen to God. It doesn't want to do what God wants to do. It doesn't like what God likes. You would think that after as many years as we've been Christians, we would like getting up and going to church. And we would like reading our Bibles. And we would like praying. And you know what? There is a part of us that does. Right down here in our belly, right? There's a part of us that wants to do all those things. But there's a part of us that when we pick up the Bible, turns off the lights and shuts down the blinds, right? The eyelids go shut and we just get all weary and dreary and we fall over. And the next thing you know, you wake up with the Bible on your face and all these kind of things. And you're like, how did that happen? Right, how it happened is you got an enemy living on the inside of you, right, called the flesh. And we need to be able to divide these parts of us if we're going to grow. If we just think that we're just us, well, on one hand, we're going to be defeated a lot because we're going to be a Romans chapter 7 kind of person where Paul is saying, oh, wretched man that I am. Right? There's a part of me that delights in the law of God, but then there's a part of me that runs to go do things that it's not supposed to do. Right? And the Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews chapter 12 that the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing asunder the soul and the spirit. Right? It's only through the word of God that you're going to be able to see the two parts, or the three parts if you count in the body. But the body is pretty obvious. It's the soul and the spirit that gets real up close to each other, and it's difficult from time to time to see where one starts and stops and the other one begins. But if we're going to grow, if we're going to mature, and especially if we're going to find direction and know what God wants us to do and all those things, we're going to have to be able to divide between these things so that we can hear clearly the right voice, right? Because there are many voices going on the inside of you and I. All right. Let me go one other place here, and that is 1 Corinthians 6:17. 1 Corinthians 6:17 says, "But he who is joined to the Lord becomes one spirit with him." You have a human spirit, right? But when you are born again, God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit, comes on the inside of you, and you are born anew. You are born from heaven, right? And marriage is the symbol or the sign that we have to help us to try to understand how that two separate beings can come and unite and become one being, right? And so 1 Corinthians 6:17 tells us that God's Spirit comes in with your spirit and becomes one spirit on the inside of you, right? So even though prior to be born again, you had a spirit, but that spirit was limited. It was separated from God, right? Death in the Bible does not mean annihilation, right? Nobody that's ever died has not been annihilated, right? You can cremate the body or you can put it in the ground and it be devoured by the worms and whatnot. It can be where you don't find it anymore. But you as a human being are never annihilated, right? You are only separated, right? When you pass, that's why we want to use the phrase to pass away, because that's what happens, right? Death, as far as what most human beings consider, does not happen, right? That's why those that are lost are without hope, because they think that mom or dad or grandma or grandpa or a child or whatever has been lost, right? And they'll say that, "I lost my dad, I lost my mom." As Christians, we should not say that. Right? They've not been lost. Right? And I mean, that doesn't, and that even includes those that were not saved. They're not lost. They are somewhere. When I say lost, I don't mean in the terms of hell. I mean, if they don't know Jesus, their hell is what's in front of them. But they are alive. They exist. Right? And they are going to be spend eternity separated from God in a place called hell. Right? But on the reverse, those that have their lives have come to an end in this realm, in time, have passed over or passed on to what is before them, and they are fully alive with God, right? The Bible tells us to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. You know, Jesus got a little bit, you know, besides himself with the Pharisees when they were talking about Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in kind of the past tense. And he's like, there's no past tense. God is the God of the living. Amen. Abraham, he knows. And Isaac, he knows. And Jacob, he knows. And Paul, he knows. And my daddy, he knows. And your family members, he knows. And they're right over there, right? Hebrews chapter 12 tells us they are in a great cloud of witnesses, and they are encouraging us on. Amen. Amen. They exist. And when you and I pass from this life, we are going to continue on as well, right? You're just going to step over. You're going to just step across a line. But when Adam and Eve sinned, a separation came, right? And that, I like to think of it as, you know, the internet connected to a computer. The connection was broken, and man could not hear directly from God anymore. God's spirit was not connected to his spirit, and man was wandering around. And so the only way that God could communicate with man from that point forward until Christ came was to write things down and have to go through the soul of man, right? The only way that God could operate with man was through his soul. So we're talking logic and reason and images and, you know, all of these ritual and all these things that the soul just loves. And you know, to know the word was to read it over and over again and to write it on the walls and to put a mezuzah on the doorpost and to, you know, to put tassels on your clothing so that when you look down and you said, well, what are those tassels for? I can't remember. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm supposed to remember to obey God. Right? But how many know we have a better covenant on better promises? Right? Jesus came and he caused us to be born anew. We are new creations in Christ Jesus. God's Spirit lives on the inside of every believer. Amen? You have the God of the universe living on the inside of you. And he's in there saying, don't do that. Or do this. Right? But we have to listen to him. Amen? We have to listen to him. And that's where I'm headed this evening. But I think it's amazing that God's Spirit and my spirit have become one spirit. Amen? That it's one spirit in there. Thank you, Jesus. There's a poem that I found by a lady named Carrie Judd Montgomery called Led by the Spirit. It says, I think I'm going to have that water. I didn't think I would. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. God is good. Amen? Amen. I'm not going to hit that panic button. Amen. I've been having a bit of a week and everything. I came in to work on Tuesday, and the truck wasn't there. I drive a truck for John Deere picking up tractors, and it wasn't there. And I thought that my boss had sent somebody out before 8 o'clock. I mean, I've only had two or three things to pick up here recently, so it's been a lot of standing around, and I don't like standing around. And to think that he would send somebody out with one of those two or three things before I got to work kind of had me a little bit miffed. And so I came in and I said, where's the truck? And he said, I don't know. Where is the truck? And I'm like, oh. I said, well, it ain't out there. Well, we didn't take it anywhere. And so then we all started looking stupid at each other. And come find out, I guess all fingers are pointing at me, but I think I left the keys in it on Monday night, and somebody came along and took the truck and the trailer and took off on a, I think they slept in it that night running the heater because it was kind of cold Monday night to Tuesday, and then they took it to, they figured, well, we'll go to Walmart now, and so they went to Walmart and parked it down at Walmart. I was like, I was about ready to hit the panic button. I can't take any more. Right? I mean, if we listen to the Lord, if we follow him, if we're led by him, we can make it. Amen? We can make it. We read the stories of Daniel, and we read the stories of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and we read those stories, and we're like, yeah! Woo-hoo! You know, boy, I'd love to be one of them guys. Right? And amen. Praise God. I'd love to be one of those guys. But how many, that was not easy. That wasn't easy. Right? I mean, everything is just like you and I. You are considering bowing. You're considering quitting. You're considering giving up. You know, and I guarantee you, they were fighting those same battles. You know, they were victorious. They did the right thing. They stood up instead of bowing down. Amen. And that's what we want to be like. But they had to be tenacious. They had to say, I don't care how bad it gets. I don't have to care. You know, we know one thing. God is faithful. God will get me through this. I don't care how bad it looks. I don't care how scary it is. Right? And if that's you, if you're about ready to give up, I want you to hang in there. Hang in there. All right? So, all right, the poem, Led by the Spirit. It says, oh, what blessed freedom. Led by Christ alone, through his precious leading, cares and griefs have flown. led by love unerring, led by grace divine, brightly in my spirit doth his beauty shine. Led but never driven by his spirit dear, all my path is restful, every step made clear. Never need of planning, for he has the care. His the goal I'm reaching, his to lead me there. Led by God's own spirit, can I ask for more? And when life is ended on the other shore, there the Lamb shall lead me by the fountain sweet, led by him forever, bliss shall be complete. Amen. Amen. How many of you know God wants to lead us? God absolutely wants to lead us. And if we will get out of the way, right? If we'll learn where to focus our hearing and listen for him, how many know he will absolutely lead us? The verse that kind of caught my attention was, never need of planning. I mean, planning is part of your mind. And it's not that planning is bad, 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 but planning is bad, bad, bad is if that's all you ever do, right? If all you ever do is only do things that you can get in a nice, neat list and you feel really, really comfortable about and you feel totally in control about and all those kind of things, I mean, you're never going to extend yourself out, right? You're going to be like the other disciples in the boat, not like Peter. All right, because how many know we want to be like Peter? We want to be throwing our leg over the side and saying, I don't know how in the world I'm going to walk on this water, but if you say come, I'm a-coming. Amen, here I come. All right, and that's where God wants us to be, right? He said, you and I are going to have to lay down our lives. Amen, meaning laying down your right now life, your control, your being the one in charge. Because when we say control and being in charge and I've got this and stuff, usually we're talking about mind, will, emotions, you know, what makes my body feel good or doesn't feel good or all those kind of things. We're talking flesh, right? And we don't want to focus flesh. We want to focus on spirit. So let's turn to Romans chapter 8. I'm going to have to turn it up into hyperdrive, so you're going to have to listen really good. Probably have to give you homework. Stacia taught you adjectives. I'm going to give you homework. All right, Romans 8. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, right? Who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit, right? The reverse of that is, see, a lot of times Christians, they'll say that like, well, praise God, I'm a Christian. There's no condemnation. But then they'll walk around like, why am I so condemned? And why am I having such a hard time? Well, that's not, the scripture didn't say, if you're a Christian, there is now therefore no condemnation. Right? It says those that walk after the Spirit, not after the flesh, there's no condemnation. Right, it's a choice that you and I have to make, to choose to follow the Spirit rather than our own understanding. When Moses went up on the mountain, you know, we wag our head at how quickly the children of Israel could go back and build them a bull and go back to partying and doing all that. That's what the flesh does, right? How many know the flesh is all about a good party, right? It wants to have a good time. Right? And all you have to do if you don't believe that is just go remember your last diet, right? And say the Spirit was the one sitting there saying only eat this many calories, you know, the bummer part, you know, the bad. And the flesh is that part that's like, ah, phooey, heck with it, I'm eating some cheesecake, right? And we've all got that on the inside of us. And if you go eat the cheesecake, how many know condemnation is right around the corner? Right? Because you followed the flesh, not the Spirit. Right? We need to follow after the Spirit. It says, what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. What's it talking about? It's talking about in the Old Testament situation when God was having to work through the flesh, that was weak. That was weak. I'm closing now. It was weak. It's not what God intended. I mean, the book of Hebrews tells us if the first one could have got it done, there would have been no need for another one. But how many know the other one is exceedingly better because it's spiritual, not flesh? And let me kind of jump ahead by saying then, we got to be really, really, really careful as Christians, because what we end up doing is we just fashion our own Old Testament religion. Right? We go get ourselves an altar. We go get ourselves some sacrifices. We go write our own law. You know, because we're not going to do the Old Testament one. We've been set free from that. But we write our own law. I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this, and I'm going to do this. And it's all up here. And you're always walking around going, I got to make sure, I got to make sure, I got to make the donuts, I got to make sure, I got to do what I need to do, I got to do, I got to do, I got to do. And you're frustrated. And you know what you end up doing? The thing you spend all your time thinking about, right? You think about all the things that you can't do, and the next thing you know, you do them. That's what Paul is saying in Romans chapter 7. And then he yells out, who's going to deliver me from this? And then you get to Romans 8, right? The deliverance comes when we understand that we need to walk after the Spirit, not after the flesh, right? We need to think about what we can do, right? We can spend time with God. We can be in His Word. We can commune with God through our spirits, right? We need to be spiritually minded, spiritually focused. Let me turn you over to 1 Corinthians, or maybe it's 2. Let me look. 1 Corinthians. It would be 2 Corinthians, chapter 5. Verse 17, many of you know it. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Right? We love it. Right? But let me take you back just to verse 16. Wherefore, henceforth, know we no man after the flesh. Right? That's King James for, hold on a minute. From this time forward, we're not going to know anybody according to the flesh. Okay? And then he says, yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. Right? What's he talking about? Well, how many know Jesus used to be considered by many the son of Joseph and Mary. But how many know that's not his spiritual identity? Right? That's not what he is and what he's all about. You know, Jesus is the Son of God. Right? He is the Savior of the world. He is the Messiah. Right? You don't even see Joseph in that picture anymore. Right? Joseph and Mary and the carpenter's son and all of those things, that's the flesh, right? Jesus didn't spend time in the flesh. He was a spirit man. And how many know you and I, if we've been born again, we are spirit men. And we need to consider ourselves spirit men. In the Bible study the other night, I said, you know, we go to our family reunions and all of this stuff, and they can really get on your nerves, and I'm going to give you kind of an out with them, because they really can get on your nerves and the way they act, but you can really stand up in the middle of them and say, you know what? I ain't even related to any of you people. Thank you, Jesus. Right? Because if we take the scripture literally as it is, we are now new creations. you are not related to those people any longer. Right? I think you guys are still interpreting me from the flesh here. I think you're happy that you're not related to them fleshy people. Right? I mean, truly you're not, but the spiritual realities of that is if you go to a family reunion and they sit around and say, well, your Aunt Margie, she had breast cancer, and this one had breast cancer, and blah, 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 and you are too, you get to stand up and say, no, I'm not. Because when I got born again, there was a line drawn. I am no longer related to you in the flesh. I am related to God. I have been adopted in His family, and there is no breast cancer in His family. Amen? And, I mean, spiritual warfare is just that simple, right? Generational curses. We can acknowledge that there is such a thing as a generational curse in the flesh. But we need to wake up to the fact that we are not in the flesh. That's what Paul is saying here in 2 Corinthians 5, what is it, 15, 16, right? We used to think about Jesus this way. You and I, even as Christians, used to think this way. But we need to think differently, right? We need to think differently. We are not related to those people that generational curses would come from. We're not related to them. There has been a separation. I am a new creation in Christ Jesus. The old has passed away. The new has come. Right? And the way that this comes into our lives is that we have to reckon. Right? We have to know and we have to reckon. You'll find that in Romans when Paul's talking. You know, he's constantly saying, do you know this? Right? Just like I could say tonight. Did you know? Did you know that you're not related? And then when we get the, okay, yeah, I know. Then the next word would be, then you need to reckon it that way. Amen. Right? Because if you don't reckon it that way, how many know the devil's more than happy to hand you anything and everything you're willing to receive? Right? But you've got to reckon it. You've got to stand up and say, that's right. I am not related to these people, or I'm not related to that sickness and disease. No, it stops right here. It's not coming in. It's not coming down into my life. All right, got to go quickly. I got 3 minutes. So I could take you to Galatians chapter 5. That's a good chapter to learn about being led by the Spirit. But now that's my introduction, how to be led by the Spirit. Number one, you need to show up, right? If you want to be led by the Spirit, you got to show up. And I got a bunch of scriptures here that I'm not going to read, but you got to show up. You got to give some time. This isn't going to fall out of heaven like ripe cherries and bop you on the head, right? You've got to know and you've got to reckon. If you want to listen to the Holy Spirit, you got to give Him time to speak and be quiet so that you can hear Him, all right? So you need to go whittle yourself out some time to sit down and say, you know, Holy Spirit, here I am. Speak to me. Speak to me. And He will. So you got to show up. You got to speak up. Right? You got to speak up. How many know God has given you His Spirit connected to your spirit? Your body has a voice. Right? Some of you are hearing it right now. It's saying steak and shake. You know, or whatever. It's got a voice. Right? Your soul has a voice. Speaks English or some variant thereof. Right? It speaks. It can tell you what it's thinking. It can tell you all kinds of things out of your mind. But your spirit man has a voice as well. Right? And when you get born again, right, we call it speaking in other tongues or a heavenly language. Now, we have muddled this all up in all kinds of doctrinal mess and quagmire. And the way that it's presented to most people, there's no reason why. How do I want to say it? There's no wonder, thank you. There's no wonder they don't want it, right? But how many know speaking in other tongues is the voice of your spirit, right? My mind, if you read 1 Corinthians chapter 14, right, it's all in there. You know, with my mind I speak. When it says understanding, it's talking to your mind. You know, I pray with my understanding. I pray with my spirit also. I pray with my understanding. I pray with my spirit also. Right? So when you pray, you should pray out of your mind, because your mind will make a nice list, and Lord, I would like this, and pray for Susie and Joe, and da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But when you get done with that, I mean, you need to let your spirit talk, because it's got things that it wants to say too, right? And so we need to speak up, because when you speak up and your spirit talks, I mean, it'll tell the Lord everything it needs to function really, really good and to accomplish everything that he has for it to accomplish. So you need to speak up. So first, you need to show up. Number two, you need to speak up. Number three, you need to give up. You don't know everything, right? You don't know everything. And if I'm challenging you in these things that I'm saying to you even this evening, right? Go sit down with the Bible in your hand, right? Give up. Say, Holy Spirit, show me. Either that guy don't know what he's talking about, or show me what's going on, right? Give up. Quit trying to be in charge. All right, all about being led by the Spirit is being led by the Spirit. Right? I've learned something in the last few sessions I've had about riding a horse, is if the horse is in the front, he's not following. Right? And he's got his own idea where he wants to be and all those kind of things. And you and I are locked like that. Come on, God. Come on. This is what I want. I want one of those, and I want one of these, and I want you to send down fire on that person, and I want you to... Right? That's not being led by the Holy Spirit. Right? Being led by the Holy Spirit is when you go sit down, you throw your hands up in the air and say, God, whatever you want, I want. Right? Mold me, shape me, make me into the person that you want. And the number four kind of goes along with it. Number one was show up. Number two, speak up. Number three, give up. And number four is shut up. Right? Shut up. Right? God gave us two ears and one mouth, right? We should listen twice as much as we speak. And it was kind of a revelation to me one time when somebody told me about prayer. Prayer is twice as much listening as it is talking. Because I really felt like to go to prayer, I had to go in and do a whole bunch of talking. You know, I had my list. I had to get through all the list. If I didn't say them all, God didn't know, he wouldn't do them. You know, all these things. So I had to talk. And I only had 5 minutes, you know. I mean, I had to get a lot done. I mean, this is my prayer time, 5 minutes, you know. So, how many know, shut up. Shut up. Just go sit down. Be still and know that he is God. Amen. Born again, John chapter 3, and this is me closing. Did I say that a few times already? Well, I have been. John chapter 3. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou dost except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus saith unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Right, he's thinking in his flesh. Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? And Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. How many of you have to have an earth suit? You had to be born of the flesh, and you have to be born of the Spirit if you're going to enter into the kingdom of God. I mean, demons are not eligible to enter the kingdom of God because they have not been born of a woman, right? And for those that think that the water is baptism, we'll go on here. And it says in verse 6, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit, right? There are two different things, and we need to be aware of these things. Marvel not that I say unto thee, you must be born again. The wind blows where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh or whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus answered and said unto him, How can these things be? And Jesus marveled at him and said, You're the one who's leading all these people? And how many know, we have a lot of dysfunction in the body of Christ because people don't understand who they are and what God really did, right? They see it mostly in, I just got a ticket to go to heaven. That's what I got. And life is going to be hell on earth from here until there. You know, how many know God's got so much more for each and every one of us? But it starts with being born again. So I'd like to say to you this evening, if you have not been born again, you can do that right now, right? How do I know? You know, I've gone to church, I've been baptized, I went to Sunday school one time. Well, if you were born of the flesh, how many know you have a birthday? And most of all of you know when it is, whether you want to remember it or not. But how many know if you've been born again, you have a birthday? You know that you know that you know that you know that you have been born again. And if you're here this evening and you can't come up with that day, you can't come up with that moment, you can't come up with that time that you were born again, that you said, Jesus, I know that I am lost without you, that my sins have separated me from you. I want to be reunited to you. That it might not be these same words, but the same idea. I want to be born again. Forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. Make me the kind of person that you want me to be. Right? If you will do that, He will do that. You will be born again. His Spirit will invade your spirit. They will become one spirit. And He will start leading, guiding, and directing you from this point forward. Amen. If you'll stand with me, if the prayer leaders will come, the music team. If you're here and you have not been born again, we want to give you that opportunity. Come ahead and come. I'm going to give you an opportunity in just a moment for any other prayer needs. But if you have not been born again, we want to give you that opportunity right now. And any one of these people up front here would be glad to lead you. All right. Anybody else? Anybody else? You've never been born again. You've never made Jesus the Lord and the Savior of your life. Right here. You want to come right there? Another one right here. Right over here to Ron. Praise God. Pray, folks. Amen. God is... Anybody else? Anybody else? You've never accepted Jesus. You've never been born again. Come on down. Anybody else? All right, I'm going to open the altars to anybody else. You've got, maybe you're where I started the service off at. Temptation, you just feel like everything's crashing in from every moment, every area, and you're ready to hit the panic button, and you want somebody to pray with you. There are people down here that would love to pray with you. Any other need, any other thing that you would need, come on down in Jesus' name. You can probably use just a couple more prayer folks down if you're typically down here. We could use you. The rest of us, if you're saying, no, everything's pretty good, I know we all can learn to follow Him more, follow Him better. And so let's just make our prayer right now. Lord, just help me to be sensitive to your Holy Spirit. Help to divide a part in me. Help me to see each part of me clearly. Help me to listen to your Spirit clearly and hear what it is that you want me to do. Let's just pray that. Father, we just come to you right now in Jesus' name. And Lord, we just ask you to make us sensitive to your Holy Spirit. Lord, we know your word divides asunder the parts of our human being, Lord God. And we pray that we will become more acquainted with our spirit man, Lord, and we'll understand better how you formed and you fashioned us and how you desire us to live. Lord, we pray that we'll hear your voice clearly and know what it is that you desire for us to do. In Jesus' name. John said we have one baptism. His name's Travis. Thank you, Jesus. Another name written in heaven. Amen. And another one right here. Thank you, Jesus. God is good. Amen. Lives change forever. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. Make sure you get to know these folks. Right down here as well. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. God is good. Amen. Praise the Lord. You know, God is for you, not against you. He's got a wonderful plan for your life. But the only way you're going to know what it is to be able to listen to Him and hear His voice and know what He's telling you to do. Sing that song and make it your prayer. More love, more power, more of you in my life. God is good. Amen. On a Wednesday night.